I'm honored to welcome you to our Naturalization Workshop and our fourth annual Welcoming Youth event at the Borough of State College. My name is Shobha Sivaprasadamadia, and I am Director of the Center for Immigrants Rights Clinic, or CERC, here at Penn State Law. CERC was launched in 2008. It provides law students with hands-on training in immigration through three pillars: community outreach, policy work, and legal support in individual cases. My teaching goal is for students to gain the skills required to become effective immigration advocates and attorneys. This requires an understanding for the relationship between policy, politics, and law, and how they interact in the immigration space. Dozens of CERC graduates have become immigration attorneys. CERC has partnered with the municipality since 2014, beginning with a community forum in this very room. And since then, the relationship has blossomed to include a range of work that includes training on immigration for our police officers, resolutions on immigration enforcement with the Borough Council, and education and assistance in connection with amicus briefs filed by local governments and mayors. CERC is the first collegiate member of Welcoming America. Welcoming America is a nonprofit leading a movement of inclusive communities becoming more prosperous by ensuring everyone belongs, including immigrants. Our center, or CERC, and the State College Borough are just two of 15 different welcoming sites across the state of Pennsylvania. As described by Welcoming America, since 2012, Welcoming Week has always been about planting the seed of a different kind of being, one that rejects fear of the other and replaces it with a kind of unity that is more than just tolerance. In the 20-year anniversary of 9/11, the importance of welcoming is really pronounced and means and demands a deeper interrogation into who and what it means to be American. One step in this includes placing those who have laid their roots in America on the path to citizenship, and it is the subject of today's workshop. So I'm now going to turn it over to the Borough Manager, Tom.
Celebration this afternoon. I appreciate all of you for taking time from your busy schedules to join us for this Welcoming Week event here at State College. I would also like to thank Dr. Wadia, the staff and students at the Penn State Law School Center for Immigrants Rights. Thank you for your partnership and support, not just for this event, but for the ongoing work that we do together to make State College and Penn State a welcoming community. I also want to recognize Hannah Babis, our local government management fellow, along with Douglas Shaughnessy, assistant to the manager from borough staff, for their help in organizing today's workshop. Welcoming America is one of the many activities that Welcoming Week is one of the many activities that Welcoming America organizes annually. For those of you that are not familiar with Welcoming America, it is an organization that launched in 2009 with the mission of providing a roadmap and support systems for communities that are striving to become more inclusive towards immigrants and all residents. State College, and the Immigrant Rights Center and the clinic at Penn State School of Law are both members of Welcoming America. Welcoming America defines welcoming cities as communities that focus on inclusion and creating environments in which everyone can contribute to their greatest potential. In welcoming cities, local government like Borough State College consider the policies and practices they need to fit their local context and reduce barriers to success that immigrants often face in our communities. The Borough State College has a long tradition of supporting and promoting the values of equity, inclusion, and justice as pillars of our community. In 2016, the State College Council passed Resolution 11776, which welcomed all people and recognized the rights of individuals to live their lives with dignity, free from discrimination because of their faith, sex, gender, identity, race, national origin, or immigrant status. To continue building off of these ideals, the Council passed Resolution 1180 on January 9, 2017. This resolution specifically addressed immigration status and further emphasized that State College is a welcoming community. Today's event will further emphasize that you are welcome here at State College. Thank you again for coming to today's event. At this time, I'd like to introduce our main speaker today, Joanna Smith. Joanna L. Smith is the Community Relations Officer for the United States Citizenship and Immigration Services Office. Joanna.
Thank you, Mr. Fontaine, and thank you, Dr. Barbier, for inviting me and for welcoming me. So, thank you for everyone who's here. Our current administration, one of the main focuses is on citizenship. And so, welcoming me and having this presentation is very timely for our agency, for our nation. And so, want to put a plug that for those that are watching, those that are here, if you are part of any organizations, churches, communities, our agency is very much wanting to connect with you to provide information about how to become a U.S. citizen, similar to what we're going to be what I'm going to be sharing with you today. So we're going to be talking about the naturalization process, how to become a U.S. citizen. So in general, you have to be at least 18 years old to apply for citizenship. You have to show a certain amount of time as a permanent resident, and within that time as a permanent resident, you have to continuously be present in the United States. Also, you have to be physically present in the United States, and then the area where you apply for your citizenship application, there's a certain amount of time that you have to demonstrate that you've been there. And then also demonstrate that you have good moral character. You have to demonstrate the ability to understand, read, write, and speak the English language, and also knowledge of U.S. history and constitution. And then after all of that, also show that you are have an over pledge allegiance to the United States, have a connection to the United States. So as I mentioned, you have to be at least 18 years old and lawfully permitted admitted as a permanent resident. So the time as a permanent resident is either 5 years, unless you're married to a U.S. citizen, then you are eligible to apply for citizenship after 3 years. During that time as a permanent resident, so I'm going to refer to it as a statutory period, so it's either 3 years or 5 years. During that time of your permanent residency, before you apply for citizenship, you have to demonstrate that you continuously resided in the United States as a permanent resident. So what does this mean? That means that any absences that 6 months to a year outside of the United States could potentially disrupt your demonstrating that you continuously reside in the United States. Now what I like to point out about this is that when you apply for permanent residency, you're telling the United States, USCIS, that you want to make the United States your permanent home. You want to live here, you want to work here. So anytime you travel outside of the United States for up to a year, pretty much 6 months to a year, but definitely after a year, we consider that you are potentially abandoning your status. And if we determine that you abandon your status, then you have to reapply. So even though the Customs and Border Protection is the one that brings you back, and I wish I had started with an overview of USCIS, but so Customs and Border Patrol is who, when you come into the United States, they're the ones that admit you into the United States, whether you have a visa, whether you have a permanent resident card, but they're the ones that make the decision whether you can come into the United States. So even though you've been outside the country 6 months to a year, they admit you, but at the time you apply for citizenship, we're going to ask, why were you gone so long? Because essentially, it disrupts you saying that United States is your permanent home. And there are some things you can do to address this. You know, you can write a letter, things of that nature, to support your application. But just so that you know that this is what it is, continuously, 6 months continuously to a year outside the United States is what could disrupt your demonstration of continuous residence. Physical presence is intermittent, so it's not a continuous period of time. It's a couple months here, a couple months there, outside of the United States. The total number of days that you have to demonstrate that you've been physically present in the United States is pretty much half of your statutory period. So for the 5 year period, it's like 913 days. And so if you're applying based on marriage to a US citizen, then it's half of the 3 year period. So about a year and a half you need to demonstrate. So both for continuous residence and physical presence. What I like to tell people is that when you're applying for citizenship, start getting your plane tickets, you know, get your passport, get all this information to show and demonstrate. Because some people don't remember, if you travel a lot, you don't remember when you left. Because on the application, we ask you when were you outside of the United States, when did you travel? So if you know the month, day, and year, provide that. If not, as much information you can provide, because we do have systems to verify the information. However, you still, even after you apply, you still need to keep track of that, because right now it's taking about a year from application to when people interview or even go through the whole process. So you could have traveled since you applied. And at the time of interview, we're going to ask you, when was the last time you traveled outside of the United States? So it could have, you know, of course, been additional time, but that still counts toward your physical presence, continuous residence. So keep that in mind if you plan to travel after you apply for citizenship. So the time where you're living, when you do apply, you know, for those that are living in Pennsylvania, then, you know, pretty much you're in the District of the Philadelphia Field Office. We cover Eastern Pennsylvania and the entire state of Delaware. So you have to have been a resident of that jurisdiction for these 90 days. Good moral character. So one of the eligibilities is to demonstrate good moral character. This is demonstrated for every immigration application, we do security checks. We run your fingerprints. Through federal records, state records, local records, and also international records. So that's one aspect of demonstrating the moral character. Whatever information comes from that, if you know, if there's any derogatory information, it may or may not affect. It depends on what the crime was, what was the result, what state that the crime was committed, what country, how it would affect your application. But the other aspects of good moral character is information that you withhold, whether you don't disclose that you were arrested for something, even if it was something expunged, even if it was something during juvenile. This is not limited to the 3 to 5 year period. This is any time, you know, from when you were in your home country until you got here, we're looking at the moral character. The moral character also includes, like, taxes. Have you filed your taxes? Do you pay your taxes? Do you owe your taxes? Or owe any taxes? Child support. If you're a male, did you apply for selective service? Those are the type of things that we look at for the moral character. There's page 21, I think, of the application. It's like 20 pages to the application. There's a series of questions that are yes or no, but a lot of those questions are regarding good moral character. And what I like to say about this, and I'm going to mention this several times, is that for people where English is not their first language, it's very important, especially for those that are helping people with citizenship applications or citizenship education, that when you're helping people, I really encourage mock interviews, because for people where English is not their first language, some of those questions, the terminology is very difficult. I mean, even for the average English speaker, it's very complex. And so when we're asking those questions at the time of interview, the officer wants to make sure the person actually understands the question they're being asked. So just because someone puts no, they may ask them, do you understand what this question means? Do you understand what it means to commit genocide or torture, those kind of things? And so that's a little bit of tidbit on that part about both of allegiance. The educational requirements. So this consists of the civics test. You study 100 questions. You get asked up to 10, but if you answer the first six, you've gotten that portion right. But, and again, going back to if English is not your first language, and even if you don't qualify for an exemption from the English language requirement, the civics portion is just a small portion of the interview. A lot of people learn enough of English to pass the civics portion, but you gotta get through the rest of the interview. You have to demonstrate that you understand enough English to get through that the interview, which basically is under answering the questions of the application. So it's information that you have, but you have to have be able to speak enough English to get through a conversation about your application for naturalization. So you have to demonstrate ability to understand, speak, read, and write the English language. So speak is basically throughout the interview, understanding, demonstrating the English throughout the interview. Writing the English language, you get three opportunities to write a sentence in English, and you get three opportunities to read a sentence in English, up to three. Now, if you fail any of these portions of this part of the test, you get a second opportunity to get retested. It's about 30 to 60 days, and you only get tested on the portion that you fail. So when you come back the second time, you don't go over the whole thing again. Only on the portion that you fail is where you get retested, okay? And like this says, depending on your age, you may be exempt, and there's one other exception, you may be exempt for the English language requirement. So the next slide. So if you're at least 50 years old and have been a permanent resident for 20 years, or at least 55 and been a permanent resident for 15 years, you don't have to take the English test, meaning you don't have to write in English, you don't have to read in English. You still have to take the civics test, but you can take it in the language of your choice. If you're 65 and 20, in 20 years as a permanent resident, you don't have to take English, you have to take the civics, but then it's a simplified version. And so I brought some materials here that when you look at the civics book, there will be some questions that have asterisks, and that those are the questions that are part of the simplified version of the test for those who qualify being age 65 and 20 years. The only other exception for the English language requirement is if there is a medical disability. And this is demonstrated on what's called a N648. It has to be completed by a medical doctor. And they have to specify or demonstrate or articulate that the reason why an applicant cannot take the English test or portions of the test is due to some type of medical condition that affects their cognitive ability to learn the English language or to be able to demonstrate this at the time of hearing. If the review of this form is officer discretion, just because you fill it out doesn't necessarily mean it'll be approved. So how this is done is that it's submitted with your application, the officer will review it, and if the officer determines that it's acceptable, then they will exempt you from that portion of the test. However, if they determine that it's not acceptable, the applicant is required to take the English portion of the test. If the applicant declines, then that will be considered a fail. So again, they'll get a second opportunity. You can either bring another 648, you know, that's as another full review and hope that the officer, you know, accepts it, or come back and actually take the English test. So. And then lastly, again, going back to the eligibility requirements, attachments to the U.S. Constitution. So the oath of allegiance is on the N-400 application. It's right before the signature. I'm not sure if a lot of applicants know that or read it. So you can know what it says. It says that basically it refers to that you, you know, are attaching yourself to the U.S. Constitution and that you are no longer committing yourself to your own country. It's a statement in that you are willing to bear arms on behalf of the United States if required by law. Also, at the time of interview, the officer asks you these questions for you to verbally say yes or no, that you agree to these things, and then you also have to sign statements saying that you attested it. And then should you be approved, then at the time of the oath ceremony, this the oath of allegiance is what you state, and this is how you fulfill that portion of the eligibility for citizenship. So to go into some more detail in regards to the interview, to give someone an idea of what the experience is like, When you come to the Philadelphia office, and of course, putting COVID in there now, you are required to wear masks whether you've been vaccinated or not. And we have guards, so the guards will admit you in. You have to go through security. And then we have a virtual receptionist. That's one of the things that we've implemented under COVID. We have so many people in that building at a time, so there's only so many interviewing officers. There's only so many people that can be, they can go on through the oath ceremony in order to observe social distancing. So one of the things we have a virtual receptionist, there's an iPad, they will check you in, and then they will tell you that if you're having an in-person interview, they will direct you to the second floor. But if you're having a virtual interview, then you're going to remain on the first floor. So what is the difference? There's not really much difference except you won't be in the same room with an officer. A virtual interview, someone will direct you, they'll tell you what it is. You're actually interacting with someone through an iPad. If you're going to do in person, then the officer is going to come and receive you from the reception, the reception area, or the waiting room. When an officer, for an in-person interview, when an officer calls you from the waiting room, they're going to start a conversation. And some of it is to kind of get you comfortable. The other part of it is to see how much English that you know. To see, are you able to have a casual conversation in English. When they bring you to their office, they're going to place you on the oath, whether it's virtual or in person. You'll be placed on the oath, then they will ask you for your identity documents, your passport, your green card. They're going to verify the information and make sure that you are the person that they're supposed to be interviewing that day. And then they're going to give you the test. And this is part of what we've done internally to try to streamline the process so everybody has the test first. If you fail the test, the interview is done. You're done for the day. But if you pass the test, they continue on to the next part of the interview, okay? Like I mentioned, if you pass, if you fail any portion of the test, you'll get retested. And there'll be a couple of results from the interview. And you should get a notice of results. It's a piece of paper, I believe, it's called an N14. But it'll say whether you pass the test or not, or whether you fail, you have to come back. And then it'll say that either you were recommended for approval, because Philadelphia doesn't do same day oath ceremonies. So you're recommended for approval, and you'll hear from us about an oath ceremony. Or it'll say the officer cannot make a decision on your case. So that means you'll get something in the mail, either request some additional information or some type of communication. It'll either be a request for additional information or it might be a denial. If you are denied, your application is denied, it does not mean that you can't reapply. However, in the denial letter, it will tell you the reason for denial and it will let you know if there's any appeal rights or motion rights, okay? The whole ceremony, if you do not elect to change your name. If you change your name, if you want to change your name through the application process, it's considered a judicial ceremony. And those are done by the courts, and it will be in the area for where you live. Otherwise, it's an administrative ceremony. You have to come back to Philadelphia for the oath ceremony. And once you've done the oath ceremony, then you will trade in your green card for a certificate of naturalization, and then you can go to the Department of State and apply for a passport. I wanted to show, and some of these I already mentioned, so continuation means that an officer cannot make a final decision on the case. So in May 2021, these were the top reasons why for Philadelphia immigration interviewing officers had to continue a case because the person had to be re-examined for English. They didn't have to know enough English to finish the exam, the interview. Or there was criminal dispositions. Either they were missing, or they needed continual review, or there was an issue about building more character. So I did some interviews February, March, April, and one of the examples where I had a person that owed taxes, and she didn't have any proof that she was on some kind of payment plan. So that was the request. So I couldn't finish her, grant a decision that day. I needed that additional information for her to show that she's on some type of payment plan, that kind of thing, and then a decision was made. And then the third thing was documents needed. When people come, when you come to the naturalization interview, again, like I mentioned, it's taken about at least a year from the time that you file to completion and part of that at least 6 or 7 months before you get an interview. So you could have had a baby, you could have gotten divorced, or you could have, moved or something. So you need to have documentation to bring with you to support that, because we're basically kind of updating your records from the time you were a permanent resident to the time of naturalization. So as of July, the top reasons that officers had to continue the case is because the N-648 that I mentioned about the medical exam was not sufficient. And so in the cases continued, again, the document situation and criminal disposition were more imperative issues. So I already talked about the oath ceremony. We can pass that. Members of armed forces are able to apply for citizenship for free. There are certain residence and physical presence requirements that are waived for them. And there are several, I'm going to give you these links for posting them on the public website. Also, some of the information I brought today was the civics questions, information about the test, also a list of authorized representatives of organizations that can help people to apply for citizenship for the state of Pennsylvania. Also, I have a fee list of how much it costs. So it costs $725 to apply for citizenship, $640 for the application, $85 for to be fingerprinted. And we have a lot of citizenship material that's on our website where you can take this practice test, where you can hear the questions in English. We have multilingual information on our website as well, a citizenship resource center. And so when you apply for citizenship, you can apply online. We're doing our best to move into electronic age, and so all of our naturalization applications can be applied for online. However, if you are wanting to have request a fee waiver, you have to apply for that through paper, because we don't have that function available to apply for online. The benefits of an online account is that you're able to respond to our request for additional evidence online. You can immediately get a receipt number versus having to wait for the U.S. Postal Service for certain communications. And you can also submit a case inquiry and things like that. So we're highly encouraging people to use our online resources. We have case processing times. You can find out how long it takes us to process certain immigration benefits. Also, you can find out the status of your case, the latest case history of your case. You can find that online as well. And I believe that is all I have. Oh, now. So I don't know if we do questions now or later, but that is my presentation.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Jenny Peters-Bacher. My pronouns are she, her, and I'm a third-year student at Penn State Law. I was a student in the Center for Immigrants Rights Clinic last year, and I'm working towards a career as an immigration attorney. With that being said, this presentation is intended to educate the community on the process of naturalization. It is not a substitute for legal advice. Therefore, if you have any additional legal questions, I encourage you to seek the advice of an experienced immigration attorney. Now that Ms. Smith has given us an overview of how naturalization works, I'm going to cover who naturalizes, including some statistics and stories on the matter. Additionally, I'm going to talk about potential barriers to naturalization and why some people choose not to become citizens. And lastly, I will discuss reasons to naturalize and the benefits included with becoming a citizen that some people may not consider. certain foreign nationals may come to the United States on an employment-based visa. There are many different types of visas that are employment-based. Each varies based on education level, skill, and U.S. need. Most employers must go through a certification process to prove that there are no available U.S. workers to fill a position before sponsoring a foreign national employee. The third category for naturalization is comprised of refugees or asylees. These are people who have come to the United States as a refugee or after arrival and have sought asylum due to persecution facing their home country. The next category is those who have won the diversity lottery and were granted a visa. The diversity lottery is open to qualifying non-citizens from countries that have low admission, meaning there were not previously a high number of visas granted to people from these countries. Further, special immigrants are granted visas. This includes non-citizens who have a special status, such as a juvenile who is abandoned or neglected, or an interpreter from Afghanistan that works for the U.S. government. Lastly, there is a special naturalization process for members of the U.S. military. Individuals who are lawful permanent residents and have honorably served in U.S. Armed Forces for an aggregate total of 1 year may apply for citizenship. Additionally, individuals who have served for any length of time in the U.S. Armed Forces may, for a specifically designated period of hostility, may apply for citizenship. In this case, the individual either needs a green card or must have been physically present during the time of induction, enlistment, re-enlistment, or extension of service. Now let's go over some numbers from the DHS Office of Immigration Statistics. In fiscal year 2019, 843,593 people naturalized. This was an 11% increase from 2018. The top five countries of origin of those people who naturalized included Mexico, India, the Philippines, the People's Republic of China, and Cuba. This slide shows the top residing U.S. states of these naturalized citizens, including California, Texas, Florida, New York, New Jersey, Illinois, Georgia, Virginia, Massachusetts, and Pennsylvania. For military naturalization, USCIS reports that over 30,000 service members have naturalized in the last 5 years, with ceremonies taking place in over 30 countries. The map on the slide shows the top five countries of birth for naturalized service members. These are Mexico, Jamaica, China, the Philippines, and South Korea. 62% of these individuals serve or have served in the U.S. Army. Now that you all have the general sense of who naturalized, let's consider the following scenarios. So, meet Marcus. Marcus grew up in London and attended Oxford. Studied computer science engineering and graduated with honors. After a few years of working with a local tech company, he applied for a software engineer position with Google in California and got the job. Google sponsored Marcus for an employment-based visa. Marcus obtained his green card based on his employment, and his wife also received a green card as a derivative of his employment with visa. After 5 years as lawful permanent residents in the United States, they were both eligible for citizenship. Next, meet Mariana, a Brazilian national. Mariana met Ashley, a U.S. citizen, when Ashley studied abroad one semester during college in Sao Paulo, Brazil. Ashley was a business student participating in a cultural exchange program at the University of Sao Paulo, where Mariana was a student. We spent a lot of time together that semester and fell in love. The next 3 years, they traveled back and forth to see each other and eventually got married. They decided to live in Austin, Texas, where Ashley was employed. Mariana applied for a green card as the spouse of a U.S. citizen. After 3 years, she applied for naturalization. Then the couple had a baby girl. Lastly, meet Fatima. Fatima was a judge in Afghanistan. She, her husband, and their two daughters were displaced after the Taliban burned down their home. Fatima and her family fled Afghanistan and were paroled into the United States. under which they applied for asylum. Fatima was granted asylum on the grounds that she would be persecuted as a former female judge by the Taliban. Her husband and two daughters were also granted asylum as surrenders. After 1 year, they were able to apply for their green card, and after 5 years, they applied for citizenship. Now, let's look at what happens after an application for naturalization is filed. Up on the slide is an image from the USCIS website. This website allows you to choose which form you wish to check and how long the wait time is. So here you can see I chose a naturalization application, which is 20 pages long. And I chose the Philadelphia office. This is telling us it will take 11 to 17 months to process the application after waiting 5 years to apply initially. Potentially, this time is in addition to time spent waiting for a visa. One barrier to naturalizing is cost. This is the fee schedule for the naturalization application. And as Ms. mentioned, it has a $640 filing fee, an $85 biometrics fee, so that's going to get fingerprinted, unless you meet a waiver requirement. These are fees in addition to costs already incurred for visa applications, work authorization, travel documents, and other associated temporary status application fees. The naturalization application forms can be complex and specific. There are many instances where it's difficult to complete them properly and include sufficient supporting evidence without the assistance of an attorney, which increases the cost. These are just a couple of examples of barriers. However, everyone's situation is different, and the decision to naturalize or not is personal. Some people may be content with a green card and do not see a need to naturalize. Others cannot afford the fees, and still others may not want to renounce their current citizenship as some countries may require. Notably, USCIS provides an ample amount of information and resources on their website to assist applicants and to make the process easier. And while these barriers do exist, there are plenty of advantages and benefits to naturalization. So there are many reasons people choose to become U.S. citizens. This slide mentions several common ones, but we're just going to cover a few. One significant reason to naturalize is the right to vote. Once a citizen, an individual may vote in local, state, or federal elections. This is an extremely important way to exercise democracy. Naturalized citizens may also serve on a jury, which maybe doesn't sound that exciting to anyone besides a law student, but it's a really important duty that facilitates other citizens' right to a jury of their peers. Other advantages include access to certain state or federal government jobs, government benefits, scholarships, and the ability to run an election. Lastly, notably, is the ability for U.S. citizens to exercise their constitutional rights. Now that you all have had a chance to learn more about the naturalization process, I ask you in the spirit of Welcoming Week to consider what citizenship means to you, the reasons you are grateful to live in the United States, and how you might help an immigrant acclimate to the community today. Thank you for being here in person or virtually. Now I'm going to hand it off to you.
One plate It's a story, the stories of many people that make that plate happen. If you're willing to listen to what the ingredients of the plate wants to tell you, you're going to have one of the most fascinating conversations. Is the melting pot. For a young cook coming to America with $50, a couple of knives, and a little suitcase, I became so much more powerful in understanding that we are who we are through the power of food. For me, opening a Spanish restaurant was telling the story of where I come from. But then I had Greek and Turkish and Lebanese, Chinese and Japanese, and an American restaurant. My wife and I became American in a beautiful ceremony in Vatican. Tears began showing up as you were listening to the different speeches, especially one I'm saying, we want you to become American, to follow our constitution, to be part of our democracy, but we also are encouraging you to bring who you are, to bring your traditions, to bring your customs and enrich the DNA of what America is all about. Is to provide for others you don't know the same you're dreaming to provide for yourself and the people you love. If you have legal status, you have the opportunity to become American. Don't hesitate to do that, because we need of everyone to make America we all dream. There is opportunity for all to achieve anything. Probably we were supposed to call America the United People of the World, because that's what America. If you want more information, go to the New American Campaign.org.
My N-400. I know that I'm just waiting for the interview process. But I know that there are two kinds of tests, or versions of the test, 2008 and 2020, which I believe it depends on what is the date that you apply to the citizenship. So I'm wondering if you know what's the actual version of the test that we need to study for?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Under the new administration, we changed back to the original 2008 version. So pretty much after, I believe it was April, everybody takes the 2008 version.
Awesome.
So yeah, just study that version.
Perfect. Thank you.
Any other questions from the audience? Hot
one. So thank you. Both of the great and informative presentations. So Officer Smith, I wanted to piggyback on the question and ask, you know, how as an officer making decisions or even doing interviews have changed? You know, is there a change from one administration to the next? Or are the interviews do they have a consistency? Because the law is the same and the requirements are the same. We'd love to have your personal observations.
Thank you, and I'm glad to say, like I said, I'm thankful to the Philadelphia office for allowing me the opportunity to actually do interviews. Like I mentioned earlier this year, I did it for about 3 months. And in my opinion, the administration doesn't necessarily affect the interviews because, like you mentioned, the law is the same. So as long as, you know, the law, the immigration law, stays how it has been the last 30 years, then it's going to remain the same. Now, what can be different is the interviewing officer that you might have. So your experience might be different. From what I've heard in the community, that people, and also from attorneys, that you know, the Philadelphia office is a pretty good office. I will say that, you know, I have heard opinions that, you know, people have experienced different things with different officers, but the you know, process should be the same. You know, how a person, and this is actually a good point to relate to someone, and for what I've encountered, I understand that people, depending on where they come from, how they view the government, so they may be kind of nervous. And seasoned officers are able to deal with that more readily than maybe someone that's new. So some of the things that might be different. If you have a seasoned officer, they may group questions together and may not go through all the questions. But if you had me as a new officer, I would do every question. So, you know, that aspect might be different. Some people are like, are you really gonna go through every question? Well, depending on who you get, yes, they may go through every question. A seasoned officer are able, some of them know enough of the main ones where they can kind of group and still make sure we're getting the information from you. But one thing I will say is that when people come to the interview and they're very nervous, to really make sure they relax, because from what I experience and from what I understand from some of my fellow officers, it's kind of difficult. It can be a thin line to determine whether someone doesn't really know English or they're really just nervous about the test. And the reason I say that, because I've had some interviewees where even though I told them to relax, but because they were so nervous, you know, they started answering questions before I asked them, and it can kind of be frustrating for an officer. And just to also let you know, an officer has about 8 to 10 interviews, and we only have so much time to do them. So we really don't have a lot of time to kind of, like, you know, really go in depth. Not saying that someone wouldn't, but so, you know, you have a short amount of time to really demonstrate that you understand enough. Because if an officer feel like, okay, this person, maybe they don't know enough English, then they're gonna have to come back. But you might be, you know, nervous. But again, it depends on that officer, if they're, you know, seasoned enough to kind of determine that. But then again, you as an applicant, you have to kind of have some confidence about the situation as well. Some of the things that you can do, just some tips. If you don't understand the officer, you can ask them to repeat the question. If they're going too fast, you can ask them to slow down. If they're talking too low, you can ask them to speak up. Some people don't realize that you can do that, but you can. You have, you know, it's your interview, you have the right. I understand some people might be intimidated. If you feel like the officer is, you know, is that it becomes a combative type situation, you can ask for a supervisor. So those are some things to keep in mind. But that's a long answer to your initial question, that the administration doesn't necessarily affect, but you know, the environment, the difference in the officers, that might be a difference to an applicant.
Any other questions for the audience? Anyone, please look? Law Center, Immigrants Rights Clinic.
words of the Welcoming America Network that belonging begins with us. The Borough of State College values our immigrant community members, and we look forward to continuing to have these annual Welcoming Week events. We hope that these events can continue to raise awareness and ensure that the Borough of State College is a welcoming and inclusive community for all. So thank you again very much, everybody, for coming, and